Hey crazies, let's talk a little more about quantum spin. I mentioned it briefly in this video, and some of you were still asking about it. The short version is that it's a little bit of angular momentum. But that always brings up a question. What is angular momentum? Which I can answer, but honestly, it's not gonna help you. Electrons do not orbit. Electrons do not spin. We know not where they're going. We know not where they've been. Particles like electrons can't possibly be doing this. Remember in this video, I said the upper limit on the size of the electron was 10 to the negative 18 meters, the smallest distance we've ever measured. Let's assume electrons are solid spheres, which isn't necessarily as far-fetched as it is for chickens or cows. If those electrons have a diameter of 10 to the negative 18 meters, to be spinning with an angular momentum of 1/2 h-bar, the outer edge would have to be moving at almost a million times the speed of light. And the smaller the electron is, the faster it would have to be spinning. The only possible conclusion? It's not spinning. Just think of it this way. Particles have all sorts of properties. Mass, charge, position, energy, etc. Spin angular momentum, or just spin for short, is one of those properties. We can sort these properties into two categories. Properties the particles have because of what they are, and properties they have because of what they're doing. Spin, as it turns out, falls into the first category. It's a type of angular momentum a particle has just because it's that particle, and for no other reason. It shouldn't even be called spin. Intrinsic angular momentum would be more accurate, but it's not nearly as catchy. Intrintum? Intum? Angtrinsic? Tang? Ugh, the reality is just so unfamiliar, there isn't a better word for it. But how do we know it's there? Magnets. Any charge with any kind of momentum is going to have a magnetic field, which means it's going to be affected by another magnetic field. We'll stick with electrons for now because, well, they're easy. Experiment time! There was this experiment done in 1922 called the Stern-Gerlach experiment. Full disclosure, Otto Stern and Walter Gerlach did not use a beam of free electrons, because that ain't gonna work. Charge is a bigger influencer than spin, so they'll all veer off in the same direction if they get too close to a magnet. Charge, such an attention hog. Anyway, you need to make it neutral, like a whole atom. Stern and Gerlach used silver, cause reasons. But I don't want to get caught up in the details of the experiment. All that matters is we now have an atom that we're going to pretend is a massive neutral electron. I know, it sounds silly, but that's how I feel about all experiments. Theoretical physics is superior. Next, we need something to control that electron. Say, I don't know, two strong magnetic poles shaped like this. Again, don't get caught up in the details. Think of it as just a spin separator. If we send a bunch of these electrons through, we get two distinct groups, which we call spin up and spin down. Since the biggest possibility is plus 1/2, we call these spin 1/2 particles. But there's nothing special about up and down. We get two groups no matter how we orient this thing. Each of the two major directions can only have two possible values, plus 1/2 and minus 1/2, never zero. I wonder what that looks like. If all the directions are plus 1/2, the spin arrow looks like this. But this is quantum mechanics. Only one of those directions can be definite at any one time. What I mean is, if one of the directions is, say, definitely 1/2, like for sure, then the other two directions are in some weird combination of both plus 1/2 and minus 1/2. It's called a quantum superposition. So spin up actually looks more like this. There are only four possible directions for that arrow, all pointed up. If we then try to measure left and right, we might find that it's pointed right, except now it's in this state. We don't know if it's up or down anymore. If you go back and measure up and down, you only have a 50% chance of getting up. I shouldn't have said that. You only have a 50% chance of measuring up. Now it's just depressing. I just mean that if you separate two groups in one direction, block one of those groups, then separate into two groups again in a different direction, block one of those groups, and then re-measure in the original direction, you get two groups, not one. It forgot the original measurement. There are always four possible directions to the spin arrow, so there is always quantum weirdness, which is true of any spin 1/2 particle, including protons and neutrons. Yes, neutrons. They might be neutral, but they're made of smaller particles that aren't neutral, so they're still tiny magnets. It gets even weirder with bigger spins. Spin 1 particles are separated into three groups, so their spin arrows would look like this. Spin 3/2 particles are separated into four groups, so their spin arrows would look like this. spin 2 particles are separated into 5 groups, and so on. Of course, this only works if the particle has charge on a fundamental level. If it doesn't, like the photon, we have to be a little more creative. If you have any questions, please ask in the comments. Thanks for liking and sharing this video. Don't forget to subscribe if you'd like to keep up with us. Also, consider supporting us on Patreon if you think we deserve it. Even $1 a month can add up fast with enough people. And until next time, remember, it's okay to be a little crazy. The featured comment comes from SteveMonkey6666, who asked, "Do neutron stars shine?" Technically, yes. They are hot, so they are emitting light from their surface. But they're not very bright. There's just not enough surface area. Thanks for watching!